Well, it took ages for it to happen. But when it did come, in January 1940, rationing changed our lives. The thing was, you see, people had started panic buying, shopping and hoarding, and it meant not everyone could get the food that they needed. At first, it was bacon, butter and sugar that was rationed. Oh, I was heartbroken when bacon went, I tell you. Then, not long after, they rationed meat, tea, jam, biscuits, breakfast cereals, cheese, eggs, milk and canned fruit. One of the few things that they didn't ration was fish and chips. Hurrah! I thought my luck is in. Oh, I do love my chip supper. But then they broke my heart. All the chippies shut, didn't they? They only open when they can get supplies, and that is once in a blue moon. The thing is, you see, some of us, myself included, have bad memories of the chaos of food shortages in the last war, and we weren't going to let that happen again. So the whole idea is everyone gets their fair share of food that's available, and only food that can be guaranteed is put on ration. So, every member of the household gets a ration book. This one's mine here, but this one's really interesting. This one belongs to my daughter Jane. Inside there are coupons. These can only be used in one particular shop, and you have to register with the shopkeeper. He then gets the supplies based on the number of people who are registered with him. At first, they used to cut the coupons out of your book, but it made a heck of a mess, so they started stamping them instead. And that shows you've had your fair share of whatever is available for that week. So, what can you get? Well, somewhat embarrassingly, I've used up most of my rations for this week, but luckily for you, I happened to make a record of them when they first came in. Let's have a look. Well, here's what's left of this week's shop. Nowadays, we can get 2 ounces of cheese. Now, in 1941, we could only get 1 ounce, and in 1942, we could get 8 ounces, so it goes up and down. We can have 4 ounces of bacon or ham. We can have 8 ounces of sugar. We have 1 shilling 2 pence worth of meat. And then we can have marmalade, like you see in the middle here. That's £2 worth. We can have 2 ounces of butter, 4 ounces of margarine, 2 ounces of lard, which I'm embarrassed to say is in the oven. And the worst part is only 12 ounces of sweets a month. Some foods are affected by the seasons, so milk and eggs are allocated rather than rations. The idea is you get slightly less than 1 egg per week. How on earth did you do that, you say? Well, it's powdered eggs, isn't it? We're allowed the equivalent of 12 eggs per 8 weeks. They're really useful in cakes and custard, but I'm afraid a dried omelette, well, that's rather an acquired taste. Ugh. Some foods aren't rationed, but they're not necessarily available. Fish, as I've mentioned, is one of them. Offal is another. Bread's not rationed either, although the national loaf tastes foul. Fruit and veg are not rationed either, and we do our bit to get our own supply of them by digging for victory. More of that in a moment. To be honest, for me, this war has been an endless round of queuing outside shops, just in case they have something different in today. Like an extra sausage or some lard. I'll be so glad when all this rationing is over. And when we win the war, which will be very soon, I have no doubt, it will all go back to normal. But I'll miss all the advice we've been given, like grow fit, not fat. That's helped me enormously. You should have seen me before the war. And the BBC programme The Kitchen Front with Gert and Daisy. It's a mix of advice and a good giggle. It's broadcast every morning, and I listen just before I go shopping, you know, to get ideas and recipes. Corned beef fritters, sheep's head soup, fried offal. Oh, I can't wait to have a proper Sunday roast though with all the trimmings, or a full cooked breakfast. Oh, said I'd tell you about Dig for Victory, didn't I? Well, Dig for Victory has encouraged us all to become vegetable gardeners. So formal gardens, lawns and even sports pitches have been transformed into allotments, large or small, and everyone has got enough veggies to put into their very own Lord Woolton's pie. The idea for this is that we, as Britain, are an island. You know that blue, grey, cold, wobbly thing that goes around the edge? Well, that's the sea, you see. And a lot of our food before the war was brought over that sea on ships. About 50% of meat and 90% of cereal come from abroad. But with warships and torpedoes off the coast and U-boat blockades, food can no longer reach our fair shores, so we're having to provide for ourselves. The Ministry of Agriculture took control of food production and of the farms that were not pulling their weight. A Plough Now campaign was started to turn grassland into crops and grow things like wheat and oats and barley and potatoes to feed the population. The Prime Minister said that we must produce the greatest volume of food that this fertile land is capable of producing. There is even Dr. Carrot and Potato Pete to encourage children to grow and eat vegetables. Mr. Churchill didn't just mean the farms neither. And in no time at all, herbaceous borders, garden lawns, railway embankments, seaside promenades, even the top of Anderson shelters were considered suitable to grow vegetables. Even the bed surrounding the Victoria Memorial outside Buckingham Palace has been used to grow peas, runner beans, Brussels sprouts, and potatoes. Everyone from the king himself to the working classes is mucking in and helping out. Then, of course, there's the Women's Land Army that fights in the fields. For it is in the fields of Britain that the most critical battle of the present war may well be fought and won. They were originally set up in 1917, but were disbanded at the end of the Great War. Then they reformed again in June 1939. At first, women volunteered to go, but by late 1941, women were conscripted. We were all asked to send in our details, see which kind of work we would do. Anyway, by last year, 1944, there were more than 80,000 women doing a wide variety of jobs on the land. Ploughing, tilling, milking, rat catching. They work in all weathers and conditions, anywhere in the country. So, it is now, in this early time of 1945, that there are approximately 1.5 million allotments providing 10% of this country's vegetables. We keep rabbits and all for meat, and chickens for eggs. Speaking of which, I've been keeping something a bit of a secret. My Lottie Hen laid her first egg today. Look at that, would you? Anyway, time I get on, I suppose. That dinner's not going to cook itself now, is it? Toodaloo.
Run, rabbit, run, rabbit, run, run, run. Run, rabbit, run, rabbit, run, run, run. Bang, 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 bang goes the farmer's gun. Run, rabbit, run, rabbit, run, 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 run.